Hello and welcome to A Conversation With, where we sit down with doctors and addiction medicine providers to hear their stories and learn more about treating addiction. We're coming to you on Veterans Day, and in honor of that, we've got a great conversation coming up with Dr. Smita Prasad, who is a program director with the Long Branch Residential Treatment Facility in Louisiana. The facility has a program focused on treatment for military veterans where Dr. Prasad works with the veteran population, so she sat down with us to talk about working in that particular space and some of the unique challenges and experiences that come along with it. Dr. Prasad attended medical school at the University of Medicine and Health Sciences, St. Kitts, and subsequently completed her residency at the Baton Rouge General Family Medicine Residency Program in Baton Rouge, Louisiana in 2016. But after several years of independent practice, Dr. Prasad decided to pursue her passion in addiction medicine with fellowship training at Tulane University, where she was the second ever fellow. That's pretty cool. She's also the president of the Louisiana Society of Addiction Medicine and currently serves as medical director for two sober living facilities in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. With that, let's dive into this Veterans Day conversation with Dr. Smita Prasad. How did you get into, in particular, addiction medicine of all fields? What led you to that particular practice?
Sure. So my name is Smita Prasad. I am an assistant professor of addiction medicine with the Tulane School of Medicine. We have an addiction medicine fellowship program there. And I was the second fellow to go through the program. I'm originally primarily a family medicine doctor, and I graduated from residency in 2016. And, I kind of just worked at like picking up odds and ends jobs, trying to figure out my life. And one of the things that I ended up doing is what I like to call litigation medicine. There was a neurologist. He had passed away. He left this practice, and it was for a locums company. And I went and I picked up a short contract to work there. And what I found was that a lot of these patients were being prescribed opioids and benzodiazepines and other addictive substances. And what I quickly realized after a couple years of working there and putting in protective measures, that I really want to be part of the solution and not part of the problem, which is what I felt like had become. So when the Tulane Addiction Medicine Fellowship opened up, I jumped at it and applied and was the second fellow. So
it was that experience that you had and prescribing those medications, that's what led you to your addiction medicine fellowship.
That's part of it. My family, like many other families in America, has also been touched by this disease. And so, there are not a lot of us that are trained in this field of medicine. And I really thought that I could make a difference.
That's amazing. Also, you're the president of the Louisiana Society of Addiction Medicine. What is that like? How's your experience working in Louisiana?
I started actually as the secretary when I was the fellow, and I've just kind of transitioned into the vice president, now the president role. We do a lot of advocacy, trying to unite our other members, ACM members across the state. I feel very, that it's a proactive role, and I've been up to our state capitol to try to advocate for, on behalf of Louisianans, in regards to laws and regulations as they pertain to substance use disorders. And so, I'm enjoying it. I feel like it's a way that I can give back to my community and also really help reduce stigma and bias that is so prevalent in our society against this disease.
And in particular, too, the facility where you work, you have a specific program that is just for treating veterans, and you work in that program. I really want to hear, what is it like to work with veterans in particular, and how's that different or unique from other individuals that are dealing with substance use disorder? What kind of things are you dealing with, and what kind of approaches do you take that are, a little bit different than the norm?
Sure. So, I'm the medical director of a residential treatment facility where we do provide a lot of inpatient veteran care, dual diagnosis. And then we also have a special 6-month program. It's an extended care option. It has IOP and PHP with supportive housing for veteran males. And in fact, I just saw a few of the veterans at that level of care before I hopped on here with you. And it's very rewarding to work with the veteran population, but they do have their own unique challenges. And so I've just kind of had to learn to adapt my style of practicing medicine. For one, many, especially if they're a combat veteran, have a pretty significant trauma history. And so I have kind of found in the last couple of years with working with veterans that part of their recovery, actually maybe the primary part of their recovery, is to address the trauma and to for them to learn coping strategies, whether it's to treat anxiety, depression, PTSD, that, you know, they tend to overwhelmingly have a lot more trauma than maybe our civilian patients do. Not the trauma is different. Let me just say that the trauma is different. Veterans also tend to may have some chronic pain issues that need to get addressed as well. And depending on if they're an older veteran, older veterans tend to have a lot of comorbidities, like medical problems, whether it's high blood pressure, COPD, heart disease. They tend to have a lot more complex medical profiles than younger veterans. I was actually just talking to a colleague yesterday who is a veteran himself. And, you know, younger veterans, sometimes what they struggle with is we have new medical technologies to have advanced so much that, you know, we're able to keep people alive longer. And so, you know, a combat veteran maybe 50 years ago may have lost the limb and then had to learn to adapt to life without that limb. But now we're able to provide a prosthetic. You know, medicine has just changed so much that we're keeping people alive longer. Much like civilian people, veterans use substances to cope, and they may not have had their mental health issues addressed that started while they were in the military. They may not have learned coping strategies to manage anxiety or depression or the trauma that they're seeing. Many experienced trauma while they were serving. And so, you know, we just have to work with the trauma first. I think it's very important. And then treat the substance use disorder more as a symptom of the disease.
That's really interesting to hear, because I'm always curious what the layers under addiction as well. And it sounds like with the veterans especially, you're finding a lot of those things that are leading to it. I also wonder, because you mentioned stigma earlier, you know, I know that's a giant thing for anyone looking for treatment or thinking about treatment. There's this stigma of, you know, what are people going to think? What do the doctors think? What are they going to write in their notes? Do you see with veterans, are there any common barriers or specific stigmas that kind of get in their way of seeking treatment or looking for recovery?
I did not serve. I'm very grateful to the men and women that did serve, but anecdotally, what I have heard is that, yes, veterans felt that they had to hide their substance use while they were active military. And so they weren't necessarily able to get the help that they needed while they were active military. But it does seem like the mental health issues, it's still the stigma is very much the same among the veteran population and then our civilian population as well.
I'm also curious, because you'd mentioned some of those things, the trauma, you know, the PTSD, the things that come along with that veteran population. How do you approach treatment in that way? I know you sort of mentioned you got to deal with these things. Is there an order that you work in? Is there a process that you like to use? Can you treat or look at the substance use first and then backtrack to the trauma? Or how does it work in your experience?
So Long Range provides multidisciplinary approach to substance use disorder treatment. We work very much as a team. We have a very strong clinical team. Many of our clinicians are trained in EMDR or other prolonged exposure, other trauma therapies. We also have a very robust wellness department, which is wonderful. And so they use non-pharmacologic treatments, acupuncture, massage therapy, yoga therapy. And then also we have the medical component. We are more holistic in our treatment. And that means, you know, we are very supportive of medications for addiction treatment, but the primary treatment is should we use medications adjunctively rather than as a primary treatment? So I don't think there's necessarily a stepwise approach that we take per se, but all of a veteran, when they enter residential treatment, they're going to be getting all of these treatments simultaneously, but we do work together to make sure that we are not re-traumatizing a veteran or a civilian. We practice trauma-informed care, and we try to meet people where they are. And so if somebody's benefiting from one therapy over another, we might focus more on like prolonged exposure versus just regular CBT. At Long Branch, veterans are also getting, individual counseling. They're getting group therapy, group counseling. So it's just lots of different modalities that are occurring at the same time for treatment.
It's interesting because I talked to another provider a few weeks ago, and she talked a lot about she was talking about it more in like a spiritual sense. And she talked about meditation and things like that. And you're talking about this holistic approach of everything from acupuncture. And talk to me about that holistic approach. Do you think that this is it a new thing that's happening? Are providers looking more for this? Is it something that, is new and unique? And what do you see in using that holistic approach? What do you like about that approach?
What I like, at least among the team that I work with, is that I think that we are a team. I don't know if the approach is necessarily new, but I think it's very helpful that we're not just throwing a Band-Aid on somebody's trauma or their substance use. We're really trying to address the underlying causes of what have predisposed a veteran or a civilian patient to use substances to cope, which is usually the case. There are just some nuances with the way that we maybe treat veterans that are just different than the way we treat civilians. This is just more in line with my philosophy as well. I'm very, abstinence-based, very pro. We're a 12-step facilitation program at Long Branch, which we have the data that shows that it's efficacious in treating, alcohol use disorder, and other substance use disorders.
It sounds like there are a lot of unique things that go on with that veteran population. I would be interested to know, where do you see gaps in the type of treatments that veterans need, as a whole? And how do you think that the medical community or communities in general can kind of close those gaps? Is it housing? Is it mental health care? Is it more in the realm of prevention and awareness? What do you see in that space?
It's all of those things for sure. Absolutely. Mental health, increased mental health services, increased housing, increased options. The biggest issue for, I think, that I see is maybe accessing care. Our female veterans there are just not as many resources available to our female veterans. We don't have an extended care option for our female veterans at Long Branch yet. They're just underrepresented in the military and also underrepresented in treatment, I think. There are a lot more gaps, I think, with female veterans than there are for male veterans. But yeah, the coordinating care is difficult. I think accessing quality care for veterans is difficult. If a veteran's in a rural area and they're not close to a large VA hospital, they might not be able to go to that VA to get a consult or referral to a community care provider. I think the coordination of care and then accessing care is really the big thing. I have friends that work at the VA and they're wonderful people and they care about their patients, but actually coordinating the care with the VA can sometimes be difficult and it can create delays in treatment, which that's another gap that we try to work with. And the nice thing about Long Branch and Tulane and the VA system here is that we are addiction medicine. We do have a physician that provides care at the VA. So we are able to bring it full circle, but I know for other services or other areas, I may not be able to do that. Sometimes transitioning the veterans after they complete Nora House can be difficult. Sometimes they have TBIs that they might need like assisted living, or they just might need a higher, like more structured environment. And a lot of times those resources just don't exist.
Yeah. You also mentioned earlier, you know, some of the combat vets from, you know, 50 years ago versus some of the vets today. Do you see a difference in generations? Are the younger military veterans more willing to search for treatment and look for recovery? You know, do you see a shift in that mentality at all?
So we do see a difference in the way, I think, in the modalities that they respond to. And so I don't particularly, in addiction, like as an addictionist treating them, there might be more openness to medications for addiction treatment and a younger population. That would be, that's just my anecdotal observation. But yeah, a lot of the veterans that I've taken care of, I think that they felt that they were kind of like guinea pigs in the military. So I do get a lot of like distrust, and that distrust, I feel like, tends to be more from the older veterans. Yeah, and we do try to meet them where they are and to have different services for older veterans versus younger veterans, because their needs are going to be different, and maybe the therapeutic modalities that they respond to will be different.
Well, this leads to another question, which is, to the greater medical community that's treating addiction in the veteran population, what are some takeaways that you would want them to know that are really important when it comes to treating veterans dealing with addiction?
Yeah, I think just being mindful of not re-traumatizing the veterans is very important, and to not take, you know, just to not take the, sometimes the pushback or the hesitancy as personal. You know, I unfortunately had a veteran who I was trying to see under my care at the inpatient level. And, you know, he walked in and he saw me, and he, you know, he was just triggered by the color of my skin. You know, apparently there were, you know, women maybe with my skin tone that in his bad experience had, you know, thrown bombs or grenades at him. And, you know, I didn't take that personally. What I did was just try to coordinate care for him, medical care for him, with a physician that was a better fit. And, you know, I think just being very kind of hyper aware of their needs, and to kind of to, you know, just meet them where they are, really. Like, I have had veterans that they don't want to take vitamins. They don't believe in the vitamins. And so, you know, rather than forcing people or coercing, we just will say, all right, you know, you don't have to take your vitamins, just whatever you're comfortable with. You know, we just want to help you get into long-term recovery. And that's the other thing, you know, long-term recovery for a homeless veteran is going to look different than long-term recovery for, you know, a veteran that has stable housing, maybe has a spouse, a job, and is actively engaged in our community. And so that's the other thing that I've really have had to kind of just change my views on over the years, is that everyone's recovery looks different. But, you know, we're still trying to teach coping strategies, treat the anxieties, treat the depression, but just being mindful that recovery looks different for different people.
And you had mentioned the risk of re-traumatizing some of the veterans. What should providers look out for? What does that mean? And what can re-traumatize someone in that position in particular?
Wow. So, I mean, I think it's just being mindful of the language we're using. You know, just if you notice, if I notice a veteran or a patient just becoming more anxious about like a line of questioning, I might kind of back off and redirect and go to a less sensitive topic. Veterans can be very hypervigilant, just from, especially if they're a combat veteran, they can be very hypersensitive. And I just really try to be mindful of language and not trying to use stigmatizing language, and not, you know, I will maybe encourage them to discuss like a traumatic event with their clinician, but I'll respect their boundary, you know, to not divulge too much of a traumatic experience if it causes too much anxiety or pain.
You have such a great story, and you know, you work with this unique population. We have a kind of a wide range of people that listen to the podcast, including medical students. To any medical students that are listening, what would you say to them? What advice would you give them about considering the field of addiction medicine? How would you say that they start to explore this field in a meaningful way? And what advice would you pass on, even if you were talking to, say, yourself, you know, a number of years ago when you were just getting started? What do you think is important for those younger clinicians to keep in mind as they enter the addiction medicine field?
This was a new field to me. I did not even know that this existed when I was a medical student. So I think just even being aware that there are, that this field is an option. I find it very rewarding to be able to provide longitudinal care. I am meeting veterans, civilian patients in residential treatment. I'll be doing detox withdrawal management. And then I get to follow them into long-term recovery. And it's just so rewarding when people come back and they now have a job, they have stable housing, maybe they have a family. And that's kind of why I went into family medicine in particular, because I really enjoy that continuity of care. And I think addiction medicine provides a lot of that. I work in multiple different levels of care, so I never get bored. We need people to help address the addiction epidemic. We need doctors too. And even if they don't go into addiction medicine, which addiction medicine to lots of different specialties. You don't have to be family medicine or internal medicine or primary care. We have anesthesiologists and OB-GYNs. We need physicians of all specialties, all healthcare providers, honestly, to just be aware of this disease and how to treat this disease. And because it's unfortunately not going anywhere.
Well, Dr. Prasad, thank you so much for taking the time to talk with us today. It was really great sitting down with you. I hope you'll come back and talk to us again soon.
Yeah, I would love that. Thanks so much for having me.
Thank you to Dr. Prasad for sharing her perspectives and expertise. This was a really great conversation. I hope you guys all enjoyed this episode. Listen, we can't close out today without taking a moment to send our very sincere gratitude and thanks to all of the brave men and women who've served our country with unwavering dedication. Let's not forget the sacrifice those folks have made for all of us. It reminds me of a quote that always comes to mind on Veterans Day that goes, "We may not know them all, but we owe them all." Thanks for tuning in, and we'll catch you all again real soon.